Now, I have my guest here, Michael Murray John.
Great.
Thanks for coming on the show. Really appreciate it.
My pleasure. Thank you.
And I want to give a brief synopsis here to the audience. Of course, this show is about judicial accountability. And the Board on Judicial Standards, which right now is the only state organization that is disciplining or is involved in a process of disciplining judges, is going after Judge George Perez. He's a tax court judge, okay? And the reason he's going after, the board is going after Judge Perez is because he habitually filed late cases and used means, filed late cases. His orders came out late. You got 90 days to issue an order. They came out late. A number of them came out late, some 16 months, some 2 years, some 13 months, whatever. And he used devious means to extend these cases. And I think that was quite clear in the hearing. And so there was a hearing that took place Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday in the Supreme Court chambers, but not by the Supreme Court. And what I went down there Monday and Wednesday to watch the hearing. And there I met Michael and had a little talk with him because you testified in the case. And I was just appalled at what I heard. But so, you know, this is about disciplining a judge, but I want to find out about your case and kind of what happened to you and what Judge Perez did to you.
Sure. Well, it's been a long, strange road it's been, actually. To kind of set things up from my perspective, I started a company called Dynamic Digital Design back in 1994.
Otherwise known as DDD.
Otherwise known as DDD or 3D.
Okay.
And what we did is provide 3D visualizations and animations for architects and engineers. Pretty new stuff in 94. And to get this thing set up, I talked to my accountant. I talked to an attorney, and I also talked to the Department of Revenue themselves and asked them if these services that I was going to be providing are taxable. And they said, no, this is a service, much like an architect does renderings, this is a service. So I went on with my life, and I was producing these animations for companies. And then in 99, I was audited, a sales and use tax audit.
Okay.
And the auditor came in, she was fresh right out of school, and said, well, you're not charging sales tax. I said, no, this is a service we're providing. I charge my customers an hourly contract rate. And she said, well, we don't think so, as the Department of Revenue. To make a long story short, the Department of Revenue ruled, I guess, that my work product, if I deliver it via email, if I have my animations or web content, et cetera, digital media, and email it to the customer, no taxes due. But
okay.
As soon as I put that on a diskette or a CD-ROM or a videotape, then it becomes tangible personal property and I should be charging sales tax 100% of what's billed for the product. And I thought, well, this will be easy to clear up. This is ludicrous.
Had this happened to anybody before?
No one that I was aware of. I mean, again,
and have you heard of anybody since?
Not since. You know, I was pretty active in that community of people doing 3D animation and things, and no one had heard of anything like this. So I thought this is a piece of cake. I'll just go to the Department of Revenue and we'll get this resolved pretty readily. Well, they just dug their heels in, and as it turns out, I had to get a tax attorney, and spent thousands of dollars getting to the point where it was coming down to actually having to go to tax court on this. And it was just getting too expensive. I mean, they essentially ruled that I was responsible for the previous 3 years, in 7% of the previous 3 years' revenue.
Okay.
Just carte blanche. I was a little startup company. This was not going to work for me, but the main issue...
That's a big hit, though.
It's a big financial hit, but the biggest issue was that I was going to be held to a different standard than any other company. I mean, no company was going to come to me and say, I'd have to charge you sales tax of 7%. And the guy next door doesn't charge 7%.
Well, did they even... When you said, hey, you're not doing this to anybody else, that's in this type of industry.
Well, they got out their pen and said, would you like to give us some names and numbers? I said, you know, it's really not my responsibility to do that.
That's smart. I think we need to adjust this middle camera here a little bit, okay? It's not smart because you have no obligation to talk to police officers and you need an attorney there.
Right. Well, I wouldn't make any friends in the community if I was doing that. And I really didn't think it was that big a deal at this point.
Uh-huh.
Well, when I got the next bill for being represented in tax court, I said, this doesn't make any sense. This is just going to cost me too much. I've got, you know, a 50-50 chance of winning. So I ended up doing all the research, doing all the case law research, and putting together a case pro se.
Oh, wow. So, I mean, that's a significant undertaking to learn the law. Had you had any experience in legal work or anything?
No, I hadn't. But, you know, it's a matter of understanding the system, understanding the rules and regulations and the processes, and applying the law as it exists to my case.
Well, I applaud you for doing that because that's not easy in my book. I mean, what hasn't been easy for me still isn't easy for me. I understand some things, but, you know, but you went and did it.
I went and did it. It wasn't easy or fun, for that matter, but... you know, I thought the case went extremely well. I thought it was a slam dunk. I thought there was no way that I could lose this case. There is, case law that clearly stated that I wasn't responsible for charging sales tax. The Department of Revenue themselves have certain rules and guidelines that they go by. For instance, if you go to a watchmaker and you get your watch repaired and it costs $50, and part of that service is that they need to replace a three-cent spring.
Okay.
No sales tax is due. You do not need to charge sales tax for that spring. It's just an inconsequential part of the sale.
Okay.
So that was one thing they used. Another example.
So in this case, you're saying the DVD is inconsequential.
Well, yeah, a dollar, 10 cents compared to, you know, a $10,000 project. I thought it was inconsequential. Another example that they themselves use is the analogy of the grocery store. You know, you go to the grocery store, the bag is just what you carry the groceries in. It's not consequential to the sale. So you're not charged for that. There's no sales tax on it.
Right.
That. Same sort of thing.
Okay.
So I called the Commissioner of Revenue to the stand.
Oh, wow.
And I asked him, you know, what the difference between what I was doing, if I do this 3D visualization and create this multimedia content and burn it to a CD and hand it to the customer, how is that different than an architect doing blueprints and handing the customer a set of tangible blueprints? He hemmed and hawed a little bit and said, well, those are considered traditional services, traditional businesses.
Oh.
And I asked him to point out in the Minnesota statutes where it defines what a traditional service business is and how it applies to my case. Or is it just silence, you know? I thought this is it.
There's nothing in the statutes that talks about a traditional business thing. He was just making it up.
No. Exactly.
It's irrelevant.
Absolutely. Well, the trouble is that these
laws... But then there has to be a tax law or law change that talks about traditional versus contemporary.
Absolutely.
And there's nothing there.
Nothing there. The trouble is these laws were enacted, you know, in the 60s and 70s when intellectual property and, digital media was not a factor.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the Department of Revenue just didn't know what to do with it. They just, the letter of the law said, if you transmit your work product in a tangible form, sales tax is due. So,
okay. So, you went to tax court, you presented your case, you walked out of there thinking you were going to win.
Absolutely. I started the timer, you know, 90 days. I'll get my letter.
Okay.
Well, you know, there's a little delay in there. There's the post-filed briefs, which were filed by July of 2002.
Okay.
So I started the clock.
Okay, so you're talking July of 2002 was when the clock started.
Yep, July of 2002.
Okay.
I heard nothing until about 4 days prior to when I was expecting this to be ruled upon. You know, it would have been towards the end of October. I believe it was October 25th of 2002. I get a call from the clerk of the tax court. saying I've got a representative from the Department of Revenue on as well, and Judge Perez isn't feeling well, and he needs a little more time. He's requested a little more time to rule on the case.
Okay.
And she says that the representative from the Department of Revenue has agreed to this, and would you agree to this as well? Well, sure. You know, I'm
you never heard of this, have you?
I'd never heard of that.
But it is a legitimate reason the judge can extend.
It is.
You know, he may be sick or on vacation. No,
vacation
doesn't count. Or plain sick, or right. You know, he may be sick. In this case, he did have. I mean, he has health problems. I mean, that came clear in this whole deal. But whether he was really sick or not, who knows?
Sure.
But so, how long was he sick in your case?
He didn't give any indication, or the clerk of the court didn't give any indication of when he would, you know, be better or be able to rule on the case. And I was expecting, you know, he needed the weekend. He needed a few days. I wasn't aware that the law does provide that as soon as he requests more time, the clock restarts. He gets another 3 months.
Is that what the law says? He gets another 3 months?
That is the way the law is written. However, it does require that that he get written acceptance from both parties to the extension, which he just had a verbal commitment. There was no written.
And that's one thing that came out in the hearing.
It did, yeah.
Not only on him, but a lot of the other judges. And this is, again, well, let me start with this. The tax court is not under the judiciary. It's under the governor's office.
That is correct, yeah.
That really blew me away. I don't know the reason. I haven't had time to find it out. I'm going to find that out so you can know why.
Yeah.
But I don't get it. That should not happen because... Yeah. You know, the taxes are collected by the executive branch, and then now the executive branch is trying you.
Well, that came into the forefront of my mind later on as this thing went on. So
you don't have that check and balance there.
There's no check and balance. Is the Department of Revenue, or is the tax court an arm of the Department of Revenue? Are they beholden to them in some way? Mm-hmm. I mean, I wasn't thinking that at this point. I was just anxious to get my ruling so I could go on with my business, you know.
Okay, so he's supposed to get this in writing. No, few people have been doing that on this tax court.
Right.
I know in the judiciary that happens more often, but to get a whole another 90 days is not, boy, I'm surprised at that, but I would think they'd give you, you know, look, I'm sick for 2 weeks. Okay, you got two more weeks.
Right.
You know, type of thing, an extension. So he got an automatic 90-day extension without the written permission.
Yeah.
But you did have a verbal. You know, that's kind of okay. But you really didn't know. They did not explain to you that he gets another 90 days.
Yeah, at that point, I didn't understand the law. As that was a...
So what happened in... 90 days.
Nothing happened. Another 90 days, nothing happened.
Well, wait, there was no call for an extension?
No call for an extension, nothing.
Did you call?
I did not call.
Oh.
I was in kind of an interesting position. I mean, on the one hand, I really wanted this thing ruled upon because my business was held up. Because at this point, I had to go with what the Department of Revenue was saying, which was, you've got to charge your customers 7%. So I was at an unfair disadvantage the entire time.
So you were you starting to charge your clients the 7%?
I really couldn't. I mean, how do you go to a customer and say, you know, I'm going to have to charge you an extra 7%? So I started to really struggle. And in fact, between the time that this happened, late 2002, I had to close my doors. I had to lay off 9 employees. I had to close. Mm-hmm. I was no longer viable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's the financial burden of this judgment hanging over my head, and then the disability to compete.
Yeah, either that or you take a 7% loss.
Right. And this was after September 11th, where business just anyway.
Okay.
So it was a kind of a double whammy.
Okay.
But it time kept going on and on and on, and a year goes by and nothing.
Nothing. So when was there ever any other communication then? Or
never. No other communication. After a year.
Did he just write the order suddenly?
Yeah, just poof. On January 14th of 2004, I get this letter in the mail. And here's my judgment. And I started reading through it. I'm thinking, what is going on here? He ruled in favor of the Department of Revenue.
Mm-hmm.
And then I read further, and I read the case law that he applied. It's the same case law that I used in my arguments, but he applied it to the Department of Revenue. He misapplied the logic to the Department of Revenue rather than for my side.
Uh-huh.
And it sounds like sour grapes, whatever, but any attorney who reads this judgment will shake their head and say, this is wrong.
Yeah.
This is not right.
Well, then you're left in a tough position then. Do I appeal this or not?
Right.
From tax court, do you automatically go to the Supreme Court or do you go to the appellate court first?
No, it goes directly to the state Supreme Court.
Okay.
And, you know, I shopped around with tax attorneys and they say, you know, starting to get represented, it's $20,000.
Yeah. And that's, you know, if you go, that's actually pretty good. There are others out there, but tax attorney, it's probably pretty tough to. It doesn't have to be that high, but
yeah,
it is what it is, you know. But how do you know?
Right, and either way, it was more than I was willing to.
And how are you going to find that person that has a lower price?
At that point, I was unemployed. I didn't have my business anymore. I lost my faith in the system.
Oh, okay. Well, that's a good question. What emotional process did you go through, and what did you start thinking? What did you question? Because I mean, I've been through that process. I can't believe this took place. What just happened to me?
Exactly. That's when I really started to question what is really going on here. I had just lost my business. I was unemployed, and I was looking at this judgment that was clearly wrong.
And now you had this bill.
And now I had this bill.
Now, did they charge you interest?
Oh, I was accruing interest the entire year and a half I was waiting for this.
Didn't they say something was like $100,000?
No, it wasn't that large. But
okay.
It was still unpleasant enough to be hanging over. And then as soon as the judgment comes in, it goes right to collections. There's no more talking, no more discussion. it's just you're in collections now.
Yeah, exactly.
So, and then I started looking into what is this tax court thing? It's an arm of the same branch of government that the Department of Revenue is.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm wondering to myself, how can this be? What is the purpose of the tax court? And I'm thinking this is just a kangaroo court to give guys like me their say, their day in court, but ultimately.
You know. Did you happen to, I know you didn't stay for all the hearings on that day.
Mm-hmm.
Did you happen to hear anybody testify about your case?
I stayed until noon, so I did hear another tax court judge reference my case, which was very interesting to hear. And they had questioned Judge Perez on a number of occasions.
They did talk to him.
What's going on with dynamic digital design?
And what did they, I don't remember the answer, but what was the answer that they gave that Perez gave?
They said that Judge Perez had told them just, I can't rule on this. I just can't.
That is interesting right there, because mm-hmm. that kind of puts, what do you think was the dynamic as to why Judge Perez could not rule on that case? Because I was thinking about that at the hearing. Something else is going on here. This is a big time. Why are they singling you out, which I think you're a unique, one-of-a-kind, special. I mean, you know, to put the positive spin on that, you're a special person. You're unique. I mean, they gave that to you. We the government, we did this to you and you alone. Great. How good is that?
Right.
What motive? What do you think was going on? If he's saying, I just can't make this decision.
I think about that a lot. I thought about it a lot. I mean, it's been it was a tough decade. I continued to fight the Department of Revenue to have, you know, the fines reduced, the interest reduced, and just nothing. And so I'm thinking, what is going on? Either the judge and his entire staff were too lazy or incompetent to rule, you know, in a timely fashion, because they just blatantly disregarded the law when it comes to ruling in a timely fashion.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I get the judgment, it's wrong. I mean, it's just flat wrong. I mean, they ruled that, again, if I transmit my work product via email, no taxes due, But as soon as I put it on any form of digital media, diskette, CD, et cetera, then tax for the entire amount that I build the project. If I build $10,000, that CD is now worth $10,000 I need to tax. Mm-hmm. What if the customer asks for a second copy? Now, I mean, is the value still $10,000 or is it $20,000
that I'm taxing? If you got two, do you have to tax? Yeah.
So it's ludicrous. The whole situation is just ludicrous. What's his motivation? Is he beholden to the court or to the Department of Revenue somehow?
Well, either it's in the executive branch. He's appointed. That's the other thing. Yeah. He's appointed by the governor.
Yeah.
Executive branch. And he's been appointed by Ventura first.
Yeah.
Plenty reappointed him.
Yeah.
And that was interesting, the whole conversation about getting reappointed and who's going to be appointed.
I wasn't there in court that day.
Oh, so that unbelievable.
Yeah.
And we're running out of time, but it's this whole deal about one judge saying a new judge comes on to the tax court and one judge is going to that judge and saying, hey, we got to get rid of Perez. He's not good, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, the dynamic of that. And so they got a lobby, and this judge was lobbying against Perez in the to the governors or to, you know, whoever's making this decision.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but that also brings in the tax court being part of the executive branch, which is the governors, and if they want to see something happen, you're appointed as a judge.
Yeah.
And if you don't give the decision they want, they could have been putting pressure on them, make this decision anyway, we need it.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you're not going to get reappointed.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, he was then also reappointed by Dayton too.
Yeah.
Yep. Too much conflict of interest.
Yeah, I wish I was there for all 3 days of the hearing. I would have liked to find out if there's any similarities between the cases that he let drag out for a year. I mean, I wonder if there was some common thread.
Uh-huh.
But I don't know the answer to that.
Yeah. So you did not appeal this decision.
No.
And you just let it go.
I walked away a broken man.
Because, I hear you. I hear you. Yeah. It is rough.
Yeah.
And so now, how did the appellate court get back to you?
Well, I mean,
dead. Not the appellate court, the board on the judicial board. Standards. How did you get to testify?
All my files I put away, they're in the attic, and I thought this is just, no one cares about this thing anymore. And then out of the blue, I get a call from one of the attorneys that is, I guess, prosecuting or presiding over the.
Well, they had an investigator. I talked to the investigator.
Yeah, Jim Molnar,
out of Doug Kelly's office, former legislator, did the Petters prosecution. I forget all of his roles, but so
I guess
talked to him. So he did a lot of the investigation, but then this attorney presented the evidence. And so you didn't even get a call by the attorney. Did you talk to the attorney that was asking you questions?
No, it was the gentleman who was sitting right next to him. So they were working together. He was the investigative
attorney. Okay, yeah. That was the attorney that talked to you.
Yes,
okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So he calls you, and what did you think?
I thought, this is fantastic. This thing is this is going to get resurrected. I'm going to have vindication at last. At least at least my story is going to get heard. I'm going to testify.
Mm-hmm.
And more importantly than that, hopefully find out what this judge's motivation is. Why did this happen? How could this have happened?
Mm-hmm.
You know, is it an issue with a lazy judge, or is it an issue with a broken system? That's what I'd really like to understand. Mm-hmm.
I need to tell the control room we're not going to do the video, the music video at the end. We got too much more information to go over. But yeah, there are other cases like yours, but I think there are different. One case, the Johnson case, pro se, he had his 90 days. He'd call up the week before.
Mm-hmm.
And no, he wouldn't call up the week. Some other cases he'd call up the week before and do these post-conference hearings, you know, to ask a few questions. And then he'd reset the clock.
Yeah.
But what happened to the Johnsons was he'd go out and they'd call in after the 90 days and said, where's our order?
Yeah.
He reset the clock.
If they call in?
Yeah.
Oh,
he did it three times.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Well, I know you're not part of this But, you know, I know a lot of these players in here. And what was another interesting story is Cheryl Ramstead Voss, tax court judge, the sister of Jim Ramstead, U.S. House of Representatives. She was appointed by Plenty to the tax court. Now, there was another tax court judge there. I believe her name was Sandine Voss. Ramstead Voss. Voss Sandine. Her name was Voss Sandine, and you got Ramstead Voss. Ramstead was appointed the day after she divorced her husband, which was the sister, Voss Sandine was Ramstead's husband's sister. So the day after the divorce, she was appointed to the court.
Wow.
And it was, it's just this bickering going on.
Yeah.
But it was, all this was brought up as a smokescreen. It really has nothing, no issue as to whether you file timely or anything.
Right.
And I saw that going on.
Yeah.
You know, but the one thing because of that, I just know that if you get one judge to start, go after one judge, they'll start spilling the beans on the others because they're not going to take me down. And that's what they tried to do. Well, these judges filed late. So why aren't you going after them?
Right.
And of course, that's the standard line for the speeders. Those guys were going faster than me, you know?
Yeah.
It just doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It's about you.
Exactly.
And what you do.
Exactly.
So any final takeaway thoughts here? We're closing up real fast. You got about 20 seconds.
I just want to thank you again for having me on. I mean, I just hope this never happens to anyone else. And, you know, I want to get the word out about this. I mean, just take a look at what's going on with tax court anyway.
Yeah, well, thank you, Michael, for coming on.
And
stepping up and testifying. It is no small deal. It's a big deal, and you did. Remember, folks, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week.
Like the forest sets on fire, and the wind takes the kite as the firefly brings the light. You said to me that you wouldn't leave, but now I see that you're long gone. The days go sets on fire.